So I got really excited to find this plant. It is fireweed. We don't see it quite so much around our house here in Washington, but it's really common in some parts of Washington and definitely throughout South Central and interior Alaska. So it was nice to see kind of this old friend here. And fireweed is another great spring plant for eating. So this one's a little bit bigger than when I would typically eat it, but when they're just a few inches out of the ground, they're typically fairly red in color, and all these leaves are kind of bunched together like this. And you can pick them raw. Some people eat them raw. I think they're a little bit bitter that way. I like to steam them or saute them up, again, sort of like asparagus. And they're pretty yummy in that form. Fireweed also is a beautiful plant later in the summer and has fuchsia flowers, and those are really great for bees. And there's some really fantastic honey that comes from bees when they're pollinating fireweed plants, but you can also make a fireweed jelly by boiling the flowers in water and adding sugar or honey and pectin, and it makes a really beautiful, very delicate flavored jelly. I would say mostly it tastes like sugar, but looks like fireweed flowers, but that's a favorite back home as well. And in late summer and early fall, the fireweed releases this fluff that are the seeds that helps it, the seeds float away from the fields of fireweed. And it's really kind of fluffy and fibrous. And in fact, it has been used mixed with goat hair or certain types of dog hair here in the Salish Sea area by indigenous people in weaving. So it's actually a pretty cool fiber that you can check out a little bit more later on in the season. But right now is the time when you would be looking for those new shoots to be emerging from the soil, and you could harvest a few to try out if you have adult supervision to make sure that you're identifying it correctly. Okay, here we have another plant that's often considered maybe a nuisance or a little bit of a weed, but this is actually a really incredible plant. This is a type of horsetail or equisetum, and equisetums are a prehistoric plant. They've been around in more or less this form for hundreds of millions of years. They really had their heyday during the Devonian era about 300 million years ago, when fish really began to abound in the world's oceans. These horsetail were as tall as the trees we have today, so about 100 feet tall. Now, they're a little bit different than the trees we have today. Instead of flowers and seeds, they produce spores. So this is the fertile spore-producing part of the horsetail. It usually comes out first, and then afterwards, the fertile green stalk emerges and photosynthesizes all summer, pumping sugars back into the rhizome or roots, which holds onto those sugars and is able to make the fertile stalk the next spring. What that means for humans is that the rhizome has these little berries that are full of that starchy sugar, and you can harvest those in the fall, winter, or spring and eat those starchy nodules, sort of like you might eat a tiny potato. The plant itself is really high in silica. If you were to pick one and kind of scrunch it up, it feels a little bit scratchy. So silica is what makes up glass and also a key ingredient or component of sand. Which makes it really good for cleaning pots and pans if you're out camping or just sort of like shining or cleaning various different things. So you can try that next time you need to wash your dishes, but be careful, you don't want to use it on anything super delicate because it is a little bit scratchy. So overall, horsetail is a really interesting plant to look at and think about. It's pretty different than most of the flowering plants that we're familiar with. A little bit more similar to the ferns that we were talking about earlier. And like I said, there is those starchy nodules along the rhizome that are edible. You don't really want to eat the green stalks for the most part because they have the same enzyme that the ferns have that can deplete vitamin B, and that silica makes them a little bit rough feeling in your mouth. Now there are some ways that you can make the fertile stalk edible and not have to worry as much about that vitamin B deficiency, but overall probably a more interesting plant to look at and learn about. And then where they really excel is in that scrubbing ability because of the silica. Bedstraw is a really cool plant. It has a couple of interesting uses. One of my favorite non-plant foods is cheese. And bedstraw actually can be used as rennet. So it's a chemical that will make the cheese curdle, or make the milk curdle, and form the cheese curds that can then form the cheese. I've never made rennet out of bedstraw, but it would be a pretty cool thing to be able to do if we had some dairy cows around and wanted to make our own cheese. It
can I
also,
pick it?
Yeah, you can pick a little bit of it.
Ow, that's hurt. So it was ticked to me. Not really.
It also can form really dense mats. So if you're ever out hiking or camping and you want to make coffee or tea, but you forgot a coffee filter, you can make a mat out of the bedstraw, kind of a net, and pour your coffee grounds or tea leaves through there, and it'll work really well as a strainer. Well, one of the final cool things about bedstraw is that it is really, really sticky, as Johanna already mentioned, and it grows pretty fast. So it's okay to pick a little bit extra of it and to use it to play tag. And we really hope that you enjoyed learning about some of the plants that grow in our backyards and our forest around here, and hope that you can see them soon wherever you live, and watch out for flying bedstraw.